As we make the transition to renewable energy like solar and wind, an obvious problem arises. The sun doesn't always shine and the wind doesn't always blow. But there's at least one technology being developed here in the Great Lakes region that could help with that problem.
This scene is becoming more common across America. Wind farms. The U.S. Energy Information Administration says the massive three-blade wind turbines generate about 10% of America's electricity. Solar power generates about 3.5%. An increasing number of homes now have solar panels on the roof. Both wind and solar are renewable forms of clean energy that produce no emissions. But there's a problem with both.
They're controlled by when the wind is blowing and when the sun is shining.
That's Nate Blair, a group manager at the National Renewable Energy Lab. Blair says as existing power plants get old and need to be replaced, wind and solar can fill the gap. But their ability to produce energy is intermittent. So then the question becomes, how do we harness all that clean, renewable energy and store it for future use? Energy storage is a high priority for both the U.S. and Canadian governments. Gene Rodriguez is the U.S. Assistant Secretary of Energy over the Office of Electricity. He says one major goal is to solve the inherent problems posed by renewable sources of energy.
What we're doing is finding solutions, cost-effective, long-duration, grid-scale solutions that will help us to better integrate these intermittent resources. And energy storage is one particular area of great promise. And we're looking at all kinds of technologies.
Canada is also working on ways to harness and store renewable energy. Todd Smith is the Minister of Energy for the province of Ontario.
If you're going to put renewables on the grid, then you have to have a backup supply, or you have to have the ability to store it. We've always said that storage was sort of the holy grail when it came to renewables.
One solution for energy storage already in use is something called pumped hydro storage. This may look like just an ordinary lake, but this body of water near Ludington, Michigan is really stored up energy. Water is pumped uphill from Lake Michigan and stored in a reservoir. When the water is released and tumbles downhill, it spins a series of turbines that generate electricity. It's an old technology, and it still works. But there are limitations to pumped hydro. The biggest one? Just like traditional hydroelectric power, which is used extensively in Canada to produce electricity, pumped hydro requires very specific geography, a source of water with a nearby elevated reservoir. There are only so many locations where you can build.
It's difficult to build new pumped hydro storage because of the locational issues, and so people are adding batteries to the grid in large quantities today.
Batteries are another form of stored energy currently being used. But as any cell phone user can tell you, batteries have their limitations too. And as the demand for electricity goes up, that means larger, more efficient batteries will be needed. And that gets costly.
You really want a storage device that can have a lot of duration, a lot of number of hours, without a lot of additional cost.
So if batteries don't cut it, and there's no room to expand pumped hydro storage, what's left?
Unfortunately, any type of form of energy storage has been really difficult to produce and comes with a lot of trade-offs. And so that's why we're here, because we think we have a really good solution for it.
John Norman is president of HydroStore, a Canadian company headquartered in Toronto, offering a modernized version of an old technology to capture and store energy.
And so what we do is we store energy in the form of compressed air. We just run a compressor with off-peak electricity. We store that high-pressure air underground, and when the grid's ready and needs it, then we release it through a turbine.
The first patent for compressed air energy storage underground was issued in the U.S. in 1948. The first plant was built in Germany in 1978. Technical advances since then with heat retention have increased efficiency of the system. This hydrostore animation shows how the technology works. The system takes in off-peak renewable energy to run a compressor. Heated compressed air is produced. The heat energy is extracted and saved for later reuse. The compressed air is then sent underground and stored in caverns where it can't escape. The pressure of that air also displaces water, raising it up into a closed-loop reservoir. The air wants to expand, and the water wants to fall, but that doesn't happen until power is required. Then the energy is released. The water in the reservoir is allowed to fall back underground, forcing the compressed air to the surface, where it's reheated and allowed to expand, and the expanding air rushing out of the system drives a turbine to produce electricity. The company's first such operation was built in Goderich, Ontario, near Lake Huron. But before that, the company had to convince investors it would work by conducting an experiment that used the power of Lake Ontario.
So we came up with the idea of sinking giant balloons about, about 200 feet underwater.
Curtis Van Willingham is Hydrostore's CEO.
These balloons were 30 feet high, 15 feet wide, and we did six of them. And then we had a plant connected with a pipe, and we would send the air out to be stored under the water pressure of these balloons and then fed back to the system on demand to reproduce power.
The experiment worked. It demonstrated that water pressure alone could push air with enough force to spin a turbine on dry land and generate electricity. In turn, the company impressed investors who financed construction of the company's first plant in Goderich, which sits atop an old salt mine where the compressed air is housed many feet below the surface. According to the company, the plant stores up enough energy to power hundreds of homes in that area. Hydrostore says storage plants like this can be built almost any place where there is solid rock underneath.
Then one of those plants, by building it, you're shutting down a coal plant or a gas plant, and you're enabling a lot of wind and solar, about five times as much.
The company says that people who work in coal or gas-fired power plants can easily transition to compressed air energy jobs because the skill sets are basically the same. So three basic ways to store renewable energy: pumped hydropower, batteries, and compressed air. Which method will be best for the demands of our 21st century power grid?
The bottom line is this: we're not picking a winner in the energy storage race. What we're doing is trying to enable each and every technology, each and every approach, to find its way onto the grid in a way that serves the American people.
While we are not anywhere close to 80% renewable energy today, we need to be doing the research and developing these technologies, these long-duration storage technologies, so that in 10 years, 15 years, et cetera, when we really start to need them, they are developed, they are commercial, and they are ready to deploy onto the grid.